Good morning.
Morning.
My name isn't on here, so I guess I'm not a person anymore. It's the Russians. They took my name off it. I'm Marianne Davidson. It's always the Russians, right? I'm the Chief Security Officer of Oracle. I'm not going to give you my bio. If you're really interested, you can look it up. But I welcome you here, and I hope everybody's having a really terrific week at RSA. I know I have. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about what I'm going to talk about. I'll have some caveats around this, as this can be kind of an interesting topic, and some of the impacts I've seen, a few different scenarios of what I'm talking about when I say first do no harm, the ways that we can think about technology a little differently. And I'll talk about medicine versus technology, and then how we can make a difference. How do we process this and think about it? And one of the things I've enjoyed the most this week, which I'll get into a little bit later, is a number of the sessions I've seen, or in some cases I've reviewed presentations for as a track co-chair, are beginning to talk about ethical implications of technology. And it's really exciting for me to see this, not because I invented the concept, because I see so many people who are already drawing this into discussions we're having about tech. So, you know, what are my caveats here? You know, probably all of us work either with technology or in a technology-based business. So we all know the great power that this has, and it's not just because we have jobs and we like those jobs and they pay us well, it's because of the really positive impact that technology can have on a lot of problems. I've been around long enough to remember, you know, manual days of doing things, and now we have computers, which means you can free up resources to do other things or be more innovative. So it's extremely powerful, and it can be a force for good, and often is a force for good, but with great power comes great responsibility. And in some cases, I don't think we always think about how can we be responsible with the technology that we have. Now, when you work in security, and my remit, I should say, is secure engineering and assurance, not IT security. So when you have to deal with things like how did somebody break this, or how fast can we fix this, you think about the unintended consequences, or how could somebody misuse this technology? How can somebody find a way in to do something pernicious with it? So you tend to be a professional paranoid. And that's actually a good thing if you work in security, and it probably does carry over into the way they think about technology in general. How can something be, you know, misused or misappropriated? And of course, perfect isn't achievable, but we can certainly get to better. And part of the discussion is how do you get to better in some achievable way? For example, occasionally I have customers ask us, and again, I totally respect customers' risk management concerns, to guarantee that there are no security defects in code. Okay, lots of laughs here. You want to do better, and you want to talk about how do we try to find these and avoid these things. But the one thing you can pretty much guarantee is even if you do your very best job, there's probably going to be some defects in your code that you haven't found, and some of them are probably going to be security related. Some of them might even be serious. You know, you don't like to say that, but that's the truth. So it's how do we get to better? How do we optimize how we use our resources to try to get to that better level in some way that's achievable? And the same thing would be true for this discussion. And frankly, the only constant in life is change. I admit I'm kind of a Luddite. I'm always, what the marketing people call a late adopter, meaning everybody else is doing something, and I'm still working on the oldie, moldy way of doing something. So I tend to be very kind of, foot-draggy, suspicious. But change is a constant in life. And sometimes it can be really good, and sometimes some of it isn't as good. And that's just the way it is. So some of this stuff is happening, whether I personally like it or not. So the question is, or all of us do, how do we affect change in a positive way? So the things that are coming down the pike can be net positives and not net negatives. And the other thing is, never underestimate the power of one person to change the world. And one of the most poignant things that happened this week, and I want to thank RSA for this, I have a really dear friend who was a wonderful colleague and did so much for the cyber community. And he was also a great personal friend who could not have been kinder and more wonderful, he and his family, to me when I was losing my husband. And they had a memorial service for him where people got to stand up and talk about how one person can change the world. And that's what Mike Asante did. And not just the way that things he did for cybersecurity, but the way that what he did for people personally. So that was my takeaway from this, is to remember one person can change the world. It can be a one-on-one, or it can be changing or dealing with some of these larger issues that we all have to face. So I kind of like this cartoon. You notice I stuck a little thing in there. Technology will save you. Sometimes people think more technology will save you. And I have to say, this kind of resonates with me because where I live, the county is bigger than the state of Rhode Island. Most of the land is owned by BLM. So if you're, you can be less than a mile out of town, halfway up a mountain, there's no cell coverage. So you have to learn to take care of yourself because technology really isn't going to save you. Now, again, do I think technology is bad? No, I think technology is really good. My concern is that some of the things where technology has induced problems, sometimes the answer seems to be, well, let's just put more technology on it. And sometimes that might work, and other times I'd like to step back and say, okay, before we get to that point, what was this technology designed to do, and did we think about the unintended consequences of it? That way you don't have to throw more technology at it, necessarily. So again, what is the impact we have? Well, anything in life usually has positives and negatives. So some of the stuff that we've seen coming down in the last 10 or 15 years, and again, I'm not even talking about the business aspects, which, as I've mentioned, can be very powerful in helping people run their businesses better, more efficiently, use resources more effectively, lots of good stuff. But I know certainly with some of the things with social media, again, and this is not to pick on them, you know, some of the connectedness. Well, that's kind of nice. I can connect with people that I haven't seen in years and find them and have dialogues and, you know, reconstruct friendships. But I notice on a personal level, my attention span is about that of a fruit fly, okay? And I don't like that because I like to read, and I realize that I have a hard time concentrating now because I'm so used to texting and so much stuff, and I'm really trying to wean myself back so I can concentrate and really learn something instead of spending 2 seconds on something. There's more information and our ability to harness it, which can be a good thing. Probably less privacy, which, you know, has some issues. But the two things that I guess I'd like to focus on are, there are a lot of risks that a lot of us don't see and then we can't really understand. And that's true of a lot of people, because we see the way that technology is harnessed, but when it's developed, we don't always have a rigorous process for understanding those unintended consequences of using it. And that's really what I guess want to leave you with, is not, ooh, technology bad, because it isn't. It's very, can be a force for good. But to try to be more systemic about how we think about the pluses and the minuses. Because a lot of times, and again, I'm very blessed to work with wonderful people who build this and have such brilliant minds, and they're great people, great coworkers. But we, there's sort of a general feeling of, well, this is really cool, so let's go do it. And sometimes it is really cool, and sometimes I'm thinking, But have you thought about X, or you thought about Y? And again, if you work in security, you're a professional paranoid, and you're always thinking about how something can be misused. So it's not just about the security, it's sometimes about how the technology, what are those implications of the technology? Have we thought about those before we do them? So I'm gonna have a couple of several scenarios here, just again, more for a thought experiment. So one of those is, you know, there's a lot of promise. We're talking about connected cars and also self-driving cars. And I understand the value of that. I think there are a number of people who might be older, or maybe they're disabled, and they can't drive. So wouldn't it be nice if they could still have transportation and they didn't have to be so informed? And for my part, I have a newer car, and I'm very I don't use the cameras. I'm always looking around, who am I backing over, that type of thing. But one time I looked and somebody just came into my blind spot, and we got the beep, 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 and so I paid attention to it, and that was kind of nice. I didn't move into somebody. So some of this is really positive, but they've already been hacked. And, you know, again, all code has defects, and some of them are probably going to be significant. So the concern here is, well, first of all, I studied mechanical engineering, but I am first to admit I am not a very mechanical engineer. It was really hard for me. But when I went through some of the machine classes, you realize, okay, mechanical devices, it's probably easier to test. You know, the gear only goes this way or that way. It doesn't go sideways and in every single possible dimension. But as we all know, code is really hard to test because of all the possible code paths and the size of the code base. It's really hard. Doesn't mean we don't test it. But to try to figure out every single way, that path through, and every single possible way something, it's just harder. So my other concern with this is the inability to maintain code for the life of the vehicle. Now think about this. You could drive a car from the 1920s or 1930s still. You might be a little challenged to find parts, but you could drive it. Does anybody think you could drive a car that's 30 years old if it had code in it? Right? Because you probably don't have the code base, you probably don't have the compilers. It's shortening the life cycle of these mechanical devices. And it means we're probably going to have more mechanical waste in landfills. Now, to me, that's a concern, because I live in a beautiful area, and I'm thinking about, you know, I like to make sure that's beautiful and we don't have more landfills. The other thing is the appeal, and we all know this from hacking, is particularly common third-party libraries, which again, I'm not disrespecting that. A lot of people use them, and again, you can use your resources on more innovation, so it's very powerful. But if I can break one thing and it's used everywhere, yippee skippy for me. And this is the thing, with a car, if somebody wants to break into my car today, they probably have to, you know, jack it or you know, break the window or something. They can break into just my car. If you can break into a car because of a common defect and you can do it remotely, that's kind of a scale of something we haven't seen before. And again, I'm thinking about the confluence of technologies. What do I mean by that? Think about this. If you could, you know, harness a GPS system plus a car that you can access remotely to break into it, you know, that politician, I don't really like that person. Maybe I can, you know, make that car go off the road. Or you can just do massive disruption, like let's create a traffic jam with these cars, and then I can go rob a bank. And police are going to be tied up. Of course, I'm inept at being a bank robber, so it's probably not going to be me. I'm just hypothetical. But you could create massive disruption doing that. So again, does this mean it's bad? No, it's coming whether I like it or not. But I would like it to come with some awareness and perhaps humility. And by that I mean, you know, even really good developers, very good development practices, discipline, you know, security focused, there's still, people still make mistakes that they don't find or make design errors. So I think it's fair to say that it is unlikely that somehow we're going to design perfect cars, self-driving cars or connected cars, and write all the code perfectly. And that does, you know, the concern for me isn't it's bad, it's the ability to do things at scale that in the past would just be, I have to go break your car personally, and now I can do it at much bigger scale. And that is a cause for concern. Oops, here we go. Okay, here's another one. I kind of laugh about this. Years ago, I used to work on a product that did label-based access control. So you had like secret, top secret compartments, and we used to joke about having who's accessing the coffee pot? Do they have right privileges to access to get decaf? And it seemed really silly that we're going to have a multi-level secure coffee pot. But now we have household devices that are connected to the internet, and they have sensors in them. And again, I'm not saying sensors are bad. There are lots of good uses. For example, if you have a remote pipeline that's got oil in it, wouldn't you like to have a sensor on there that tells you there's a problem with the pipeline before it blows? That's a good use of technology, right? Lots of good uses. But I look at this and say, well, what problem are we actually solving by making all our household devices, or a lot of them, internet connected? And you know, I'm sure you've seen the ads where somebody's in the grocery store and say, oh dang, am I out of eggs? Let me check. And you go look in the camera, oh yeah, oh, I've got eggs, I don't have to get them. But then I ask the question, well, who else can see that? I'm sure no hacker would be able to access your refrigerator, notice that nothing has moved in the last 3 weeks, by which he or she can conclude, A, you're on a weird diet, B, you kicked the bucket and you're on your floor, or C, you're gone and yours is a good house to burgle, and I don't even have to do a drive-by. Woo-hoo, this is great if I'm a bad guy. And the answer to this to me is not that my kitchen needs a firewall. I would rather not, personally, not have this stuff in here. And they actually have had household devices now, including refrigerators, co-opted as part of a botnet. So now I'm attacking, you know, I'm part of a DDoS. So, and again, can the software be maintained for the life of a refrigerator? And maybe it doesn't matter if it's not critical to the functioning of the refrigerator. But it's still, why is it there, and can I turn it off, and all these things. So my takeaway to this is, again, is this coming whether I like it or not? Yes, it's already here. But many mechanical devices don't profit. They don't need internet access, and I would argue that they don't profit by them. But we do it because we can do it, and now we have problems like, you know, your refrigerator is part of a botnet. Maybe we shouldn't go there. Another one is a nuclear reactor. Now, again, this is not my area of expertise, so somebody can certainly say, oh, you don't understand this at all. But the way that I'm thinking about this problem is about how do you understand the scope of risk, and what is your sometimes we say attack surface, but it's also your ability to control and measure the risk. So historically, if you want to go in a reactor and move the rods in and out, you know, it's not like I can't just walk in on the street, go into a plant, somebody's going to let me in. They're not going to do that. I don't know you. You're not qualified. It's going to be, it's protected. There are, you need physical access, and it's people who have been well vetted. So it's kind of a limited risk. You have to physically go there. You have to do it. I have to know you. I've got gun gates and guards. So it doesn't mean nothing bad could ever happen, but it means that it's something I can measure and control. And now you have concerns because, again, not my area of expertise, but industrial control systems in some cases were not designed to be kind of internet accessible. And people put these systems together where they have the, you know, the parts of your organization that would be internet connected now connect into the other. And it creates, so think about this, would you want anybody in the world, theoretically, to be able to get into a network and do something like that? Of course not. And how do you make sure that that doesn't happen? Well, in the old world, it was kind of understood, okay, I needed physical access, I was vetted, so that was measurable. This one is much more exponential if you didn't get it right. And I don't know how you acceptably mitigate that. I actually had a friend who was a who told me that he'd actually gotten access to a nuclear power plant from the internet, which needless to say isn't supposed to happen. All right, now he was a good guy, so he reported and it worked with people, but I think about that and said, again, am I saying progress is bad or technology is bad? No, I'm not. It's very powerful. But I'd like people to think about how can we measure the risk and how can we have a reasonable confidence that we understand it well. Because it's a lot harder. If anybody with a browser can do X, theoretically, how do you know that you've actually mitigated that risk to something you can live with? Okay. I'm pretty sure they don't have a laptop when you're going to the pearly gates. Hope not. So I want to kind of get back to why did I call my talk First Do No Harm? So you think about, I don't have anybody in my family who's a doctor, but medicine is a profession. And by that, you know, people are licensed, there's accountability, they have to maintain their professional proficiency. I started down the path to be a professional engineer. I didn't get a PE license, but I was going down that path. When again, be a PE and you have to get a proficiency and maintain it. So the thing that most of us know, even if you're not a doctor, is the Hippocratic Oath, first do no harm. And that they take that seriously. And the profession in general has a notion of informed consent, including clinical trials. What do I mean by that? If you're going to be on an experimental drug or you're in a clinical trial, you're told you're in a clinical trial. It's not somebody's not using you as a guinea pig without your consent or your understanding. Has anybody here had carpal tunnel? Okay, I'm surprised because, you know, you do spend a lot of time on keyboards, and this is what happened to me. I had two hand surgeries last year. So I had a very good orthopedic surgeon, but it was, well, okay, we can't guarantee a successful outcome. We may not be able to reverse the neuropathy, meaning the numbness in your fingers. You know, I knew what I was getting into, what the risk might be. And it's actually, she was very good. The prep work takes longer than actually doing the surgery. But I still knew what I was getting into, didn't have a guaranteed positive outcome. Happily, I did have a positive outcome, but I knew what I was getting into, and it was a professional discussion. So I, as a patient, knew what the risks were, which is great. Understanding side effects. If you're going to use a drug or a device, they have a lot of testing. There's a whole FDA process to go through. You don't just kind of drop something on someone and see how it works. And again, risk versus reward. And a lot of us have probably had to go through this, and I did when my husband died, is how... What is the outcome of more treatment? What is the likely outcome of that? So it's an informed discussion. You think, well, what's the risk of this versus the reward? And even on medications, if you see these ads where they're shilling some drug, they always have this whole fast somebody at the end talking very quickly about side effects include blah 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 blah. So the point is, you know, you first do no harm. It's informed consent. You're not used as a guinea pig. It doesn't mean every doctor is perfect or every process is perfect, but it's actually very well established in terms of how do we approach this. And technology tends to be a little different. And I have profession in quotes, not as a disrespect, but because, you know, there isn't professional licensing. There are certifications you can get as being a firewall expert, but it's not profession in the same sense as, say, being an attorney or an engineer or it is. And as I mentioned, I think one of the concerns I have is that the it's almost a mantra, almost, that more technology will solve problems created by technology. And that is of concern to me because, as I said, I'm not saying that that doesn't necessarily work, but I would rather that someone steps back and says, before they get to that point, what are those unintended consequences? And unintended consequences could be how the technology could be misused, it could be how it's broken, it can be the abuse of technology that was designed for a good purpose, but maybe used for not a good purpose, to think about all those things before we get to that point. So there is, you already had a chance to mitigate or lessen or address those unintended consequences. Uninformed consent. And I have some examples of this. So there was a I actually wrote a letter to the Wall Street Journal about this, but they didn't publish it. There was a guy who ran a one of those dating, you know, online dating services. And it came out that they were actually gaming the feeds. They were using their customer pool as guinea pigs for experiments they were doing with how the feeds came through. I'm thinking, and the comment was, well, you know, no one knows what they want until we tell them. And I'm thinking, okay, aside from everything else, you used your customers for experiments and you didn't tell them you were doing this. And I would think a lot of people would have some concerns about that. I don't think that's ethical. It wasn't informed consent. In some cases, the testing is, when I say inconsistent, it's because, you know, we don't really have a standard for that. I think most people who build technical systems understand we have to do a lot of testing before we roll them out, but it's not as if there is a norm around that. And sometimes things do get rushed out faster than they should. Sometimes we don't understand the side effects. Now, one of the things that I found, I mentioned earlier that I thought there were some really good presentations at RSA that had to now talk about, again, some of these side effects. And some of them were in the machine learning track. And the only reason I know this is because I was reviewing these presentations as, you know, we'd selected things. And I learned a lot just reviewing people's PowerPoints. And they're talking about the problems with algorithms and having bias. And how do we identify that? You know, well, sometimes it's because there's a training set. And you pick a training set and you train the algorithm. And then you didn't realize that the data set itself was biased. So one of the examples they used was a company that was, you know, and again, this is sort of the norm now. You know, we don't, nobody mails in a paper resume and someone reads it and then calls you back. It's all kind of submitted online and you have things that go through, look for keywords. But the data set they had was unintentionally, it was actually very biased. It was kind of rejecting a lot of women's resumes for various reasons. And so, well, that obviously wasn't the intent of that, and part of it was the training set they used were all men's resumes. Well, it turns out that, you know, there's some women's colleges, so they were ignoring those, and you know, it turned out men also tend to use different words to describe their professional accomplishments. Was that their intent? Of course it wasn't their intent. But it kind of gets back to the awareness of, you know, how you train these things. These data sets can have if that data set is biased, then the outcome may be biased, and that's not what your intent was. There were also discussions of looking at the you know, ethics of the algorithm itself, and how do we analyze it for things like fairness in a way that we're not giving them our secret sauce. Hey, I've got to put my algorithm out there so everybody gets it, now they can copy it. But how do I analyze it for those ethical norms? If, you know, fairness, not biased, that's really powerful. I was really happy to see that. Sometimes, you know, back to technology, reward offered trumps risk. And part of this is economics. If I can be first to market, I get a market advantage. So there is an incentive. And again, is this bad? No, that's economics. That's the way things work. But the one that I'm really concerned about is this thing that I introduced earlier, which is this concept of systemic risk. Now, somebody said, what is the systemic risk? Well, we've actually had kind of a indicator of this in the last few days, because when you study financial market theory, they talk about, and this is why financial markets are regulated, you can balance your portfolio. So in other words, this stock goes up, you know, this one goes up as certain things happen, and this one goes down, so I can balance the risk, and of course I don't have all my money in one thing. But if the whole market goes down, you cannot mitigate market risk, because the whole thing is now going down. So that is what systemic risk is, the risk that the entire system fragments. And that sort of happened with in 2008 with the housing market meltdown. So the point is, if we create systemic risk because we deployed some technology across a vast surface that didn't have perhaps the, we didn't understand that risk, we've created something that can't really be mitigated. It has to be avoided. So again, am I saying technology bad? No, technology good. Powerful uses, but with great power comes responsibility to avoid some of these things. Okay, where are we? Okay, I like this one. This is not a shill piece for Oracle, but I have to say one of the reasons I get asked, why are you still at Oracle? Well, I like the company, they're really good to me. But what I like the most is I work for a company where if you have a problem in security, they want to hear about it. They don't want to, you know, la la la, I don't want to hear that. And that's really good. That's kind of one of the problems we need to solve as an industry, that security needs to be a cultural norm. And it isn't just the QA people, the hacking team, the CISO organization. Every organization doesn't need the same exact security culture, but we do need a culture of security because it does need, to some extent, to be everybody's job. Not to the same degree, but it needs to be a cultural norm, because if it isn't, we're not going to solve some of these things. Okay, so where are we? What do we do? Well, one of them is to be a questioner. So, you know, one of the things that's changed since I started working in tech, and again, I'm not disrespecting new innovative companies, but most of the things that we built used to be things that people run businesses on. And now you have different market segments, and I kind of laugh about this because every once in a while you meet somebody, and again, you know, kudos to innovators and entrepreneurs who do things I couldn't even begin to do. But when you hear somebody go, oh my God, like we need an app to like share toilet paper preferences with my BFFs, oh my God, it's gonna be like the coolest thing ever. And I just kind of look at, well, are you solving a problem anybody really cares about? And also, you know, quite honestly, if you're that gifted and talented, you'd really like to see somebody use that on something that's got a little more meaning to it. But that's that person's choice. But does a technology solve a problem that people care about? Now, of course, having said that, sometimes people solve a problem you didn't even know you had, and they do it so great, and it catches on, and they do really well. Good for them. Good for them, because I don't have that kind of moxie. But does the technology solve something better, cheaper, or faster than what you're doing now? Because frankly, if you're in a business, I don't just want to know about the latest cool frabistat that solves all problems using machine learning, artificial intelligence, blockchain, big data analytics, and what's the other one? Zero trust. Those are the buzzwords this week. And gets rid of cellulite, very important. I would really like to know if it's, again, am I solving something I care about, and is it doing it better than what I do now, or lower cost, or more innovative way, or maybe I need 5x less people, I can put them on something higher value add. And if it doesn't, why are we doing it? Why are we doing this? Does it create externalities? That's an economics term. You know, what's an externality? I have a power. I have a plant. I'm making something. I take all the icky stuff left from my manufacturing, and I stick it in the river and let it go down the river. That's an externality because that creates a problem for somebody else. That was part of my manufacturing process, and now because I've dumped it in the river, I've created pollution. That's an externality, and that's why, you know, regulations in part deal with externalities. So does it create an externality? Is the long-term cost greater than the benefits of this? Am I creating something that is going to be beneficial, or is there a hidden cost I had to think about? And again, does it create systemic risk? So it's something we need to think about, and a lot of times it's just in the weeds on the technology. Broader mechanisms for change. And again, I noted that I was so pleased to hear so many sessions where people were talking about ethics and implications of technology in all these other sessions. That is a big change from what I've seen in prior years, and I'm really pleased to see that. But part of it goes back to educational systems. And I do think it needs to be part of the curriculum. And part of the reason I feel strongly about this is because I did experience this. I went to the University of Virginia, and they had a humanities division in the engineering school. And this was a long time ago. We're not talking about how long ago it was exactly, because I joined, like got graduated when I was 3, but it's actually very good. I had to read Moore's Utopia, Plato's Republic. Half of my grade on anything like a lab was graded by the English department because they wanted you to be able to talk about the role of technology in society in those discussions, and how you communicate was important. It's not just how good a geek you are, and I wasn't a very good geek, but I was a pretty good communicator, and that was really powerful. And when I say technology is ephemeral, it doesn't mean it's bad, but think about this. Okay, how many of us can, you know, learn basic Fortran? Okay, does anybody use that anymore? It's kind of like Akkadians, like, you know, that a dead language of Assyria, right? People don't really use that anymore. That doesn't mean it's bad, it just means a lot of the things that are new, cool, and hip, in 3 or 4 years they're obsolete. So, but ethical norms are a lot less obsolete quickly. And that is why it needs to be part of the educational system. So we do talk about this. How could this be used? How could it be abused? And if that becomes the norm, then we will have fewer of these kind of oopsie moments later when someone didn't realize what something did. A code of ethics, I think, would be important. And again, I was very pleased that the session I went to on Wednesday that talked about this, they were talking about a number of different frameworks that do talk about ethics and ethical norms. You know, privacy obviously would be one of them, but there were a number of different, if not regulatory, certification regimes that talked about ethics, and it was now part of that. That's a really good thing. Or incorporating ethics tracks. Now again, I think RSA, maybe not formally, but ethics has become part of this discussion on so many of the almost all the presentations I reviewed, and some of the sessions I've attended, that's really a positive development. I cannot stress how happy I think I am about that. And if we don't talk about this and what has become an acceptable use of technology, is something nothing will change. Now, of course, I've talked very, you know, kind of, you know, high level about this, but there are a number of things I was reading about before I in the last few weeks to get ready for this conference. And I'll give you a couple other ones, just a couple of real for instances. For example, one of them was, and again, I'm not naming names because they're not here to defend themselves. I'm not trying to bash a vendor or a service provider. But one of the devices that you use to see, okay, who's at my door? Oh, this is kind of cool. I can see somebody dropping a package up. Well, it turns out that data is being shared with a number of other companies. And I think, why would someone need to do that? So there are other corollaries that these other companies can draw between your other behavior and the fact that you just happen to want something there so I can see, is somebody coming to my door to try to break in? Why should that even be an issue? Why shouldn't there have been some disclosure? Why should the fact that I want to maybe protect my home a little better be a cause for data being gathered and given to somebody else who had no knowledge of that? I don't think that's ethical. I personally don't think that's ethical. Other things where, again, it was unintentional. For example, it's an interesting one. There was an algorithm a financial institution was using to try to figure out, you know, who to successfully loan money to, you know, who's going to be a better risk. Good, sounds good to me. That's a useful thing that a bank should do. And they found that one of the things that was a factor for correlation is zip code. Woohoo, easy. Anybody got a problem with that? There's a law against redlining. And that was the practice by which people did that. You live in this neighborhood, you're bad credit risk. Okay, well, correlation is not necessarily causality. That might, you know, be a loose way to gather it, but it's different from actually looking at a particular individual. Okay, are you earning a job? You know, how much credit card debt do you have? You know, where you're actually evaluating a particular individual. That's why people went to credit scores. Now, how did they make that mistake? Well, in part because they didn't have the people developing the algorithm were all technical people. Again, nothing bad with being a technical person, God bless them. But they didn't have an attorney, they didn't have anybody who's kind of outside the little group to say, hey, wait just a minute, I know you didn't mean to do this, but redlining is against the law, so you can't use zip code. So the perfectly lovely algorithm, which happened to be perfectly illegal, wasn't intent, but that was the result. Another one, I guess I could use an example, I was trying to think of one, is, I wouldn't say it's unethical, but it gets back to how you use the data. If somebody were to do an analysis of the health of construction industries based on Gulfport, Mississippi and Port Hueneme, California, and you're saying, why did she pick those? I'll tell you why in a minute. Oh, great, it looks really good. There's a really healthy construction industry. Well, okay, and why would it be true there? Because Gulfport, I was a CB, okay, Naval Military Construction Battalion person when I was in the Navy. Those are two places where there are naval construction training centers. So there's lots of young men and women who are learning the building trades. There's big naval bases there for that. So if you're going to use that as your data set, you're going to come up with maybe the construction trades are in good shape, but if you're picking the two places where they're training construction people, you're not really going to get a very good result. It's not going to be an accurate result. So if we don't know how we're doing something, why we're doing it, and what is an ethical and acceptable use of technology, we're not going to change this. But I do think, as said, based on what I've seen in this conference, things are starting to change. We can all be change agents. So again, what can one person do? I always like the phrase, let your yes be yes and your no be no. It happens to be from the Bible, but it's actually very good business sense. I always tell my team, we are being paid for best professional advice and we should give it, and you should speak freely. Not uninformed, you should have good reasons for it, but you should speak up. And if your boss or your management makes a change or a decision you don't agree with, well, you carry it out to the best of your abilities. If you think it's unprincipled, you can resign on principle. But you should speak freely and with conviction and also with good data or good options. And I've never heard anybody shut me down because they might have disagreed and they might have had a good reason to disagree because, hey, I missed something in my argument or I didn't think about something else. But that is what helps bring some of these issues out to light, that somebody says, I know you didn't mean this, but have you thought about such and such? And I think that's important. Explaining technical concerns in layman's language. I have ethical hackers who work for me. And I say very freely, everything they learned about ethical hacking, They didn't learn from me, because I can't hack my way out of a paper bag with a machete. But they're really good at what they do. And they're also very good explaining what they did in terms that, you know, blondes can understand, and also in a way that is not threatening to the development teams who have to make these improvements. And when I listen to them present, because they usually do a dry run by me, I will say, well, this is like that, so to make sure I understand what they did. And they say, no, this is more like that other that. But I incorporate analogies and other things into my discussions with people so that we can explain this in ways that other people understand. Because nothing is more annoying than somebody getting in front, we need a secure Fabrostat protocol. It's so important to have a secure Fabrostat protocol. And I care why. I'm sure it is important, but why? What is that going to do for me? What problem does that solve? How is that going to help? So there's one that, I mean, I use a lot of analogies, and I find that that is helpful for the penny to drop to somebody else. I know it works for me, because that's the way that I understand things that are not immediately, I'm not immediately conversant with. Enlisting allies, I talked about the fact that one of these firms unintentionally created an algorithm that broke the law. And I'm sure it wasn't their intent to do that. They're very bright people working on this, and they wanted to do something really, really great to figure out how do we, you know, better allocate our money that we have to make loans to people. But if you have other people in your circle, you're more likely to, you know, they talk about one of the ways you can help avoid bias when you're creating some of these algorithms is to, you know, have a less biased team. And that's true. But particularly if you're going to be in an area where you are not the expert, having other people, like, you know, I work really close with our privacy and legal people, and I always ask them questions, not because I'm questioning their skills. So I learn their thought process. So when I'm doing what I do, I can think, huh, legal such and such, I need to be aware of that as I'm doing X. It doesn't mean I still won't run something by them, but I can catch things earlier, head things off the pass earlier, and that kind of reduces their workload potentially if I've thought about the way they think about things and helps me make avoid some mistakes. So getting those other kahunas in the room with you when you're doing some of this work, figure out what is it we're trying to do with this, how is it going to be used, and getting those perspectives. And having this balance that we, again, technologists are not just, you know, it's kind of unfortunate because, you know, as we've, things become more and more and more specialized, and I still think it's really important there's a role for generalists. And I know, you know, somebody asked me, well, do you read all these books on security or whatever? I said, I try to learn about one new thing a day in my area of security. But I also try to read very broadly in other areas because it changes the way I think about these problems. Plus, the world is bigger than this. So to be able to incorporate these other things, you know, economics, or sometimes I look at biology, or it changes the way that you think about some of these problems. And that helps you be better, but it also gives you a much larger perspective to frame these things. Oops. Okay, so summarize, don't be this guy. Admit no harm. I made some really beaut mistakes in my career, and one of the things I say is you gotta own them. I hope that I don't repeat them. I hope I've learned from them. I try to own them. I try to explain to people, boy, I really blew it on that one. Here's what I learned from it. But definitely, you know, try to be an honorable person. That's one of the ways that we infuse these discussions with ethics. So again, we can't always solve it by more technology. We need to think about how things can be abused. So it's not, it doesn't mean nothing bad will ever happen. It means that we can harness the power of technology for all the good that it has done, it can do, and it will continue to do. And we will do it with less unintended consequences of it. And I think making ethics part of the norm will help help raise the bar and be, it will help make technology even more of a force for good. So again, that's the last thing I have. First, do no harm. Go out, do good in the universe. Oh, I got one more, because I have the takeaways. Oh, I thought I had one. Are we skipping it? Sorry. There was a, please, I did have a slide in there about what you're supposed to take away, and for some reason it didn't show up here. Those Russians again, it's their fault. So anyway, any questions? I scared you all. Nobody's had enough coffee. Anyway, yes, go for it.
So I've got a systemic question about the software industry. Don't take this personally. Your company does it too. But they all do.
Sorry.
This isn't personal. I think you should have named this first, do no harm, and second, kill all the witnesses if they saw you do it.
Oh.
Because the software industry does a lot of harm. There's just a lot of crap software that's put out there with vulnerabilities that cause harm. And the latest example was 8-year-old girl in her bedroom and the Ring camera can see her, and the guy outed himself stupidly by talking to her and she, you know, demonstrating that he had access to her camera. He could have kept that video for himself and done whatever with it, posted it on a child porn site or whatever. But there is a statement in the EULA that she had to accept in order to install a camera that said, you can't sue us for this. Now, in no other industry in the world can you just put a statement in your terms and conditions that say, we don't have to obey the law. Product liability laws don't apply to us, and if you use our product, you're agreeing to that. You can't waive your legal rights in any other industry. But somehow, Congress and law enforcement has turned the blind eye to this and allowed the software industry to get away with this forever. Why is that happening?
Oh, what you're asking is something that's probably beyond my obviously legal skills. But I kind of put it in a different way when I'm talking to my team and others about it, which is, let's see, how do I put this? For a couple things. First of all, if you do the right thing, and I'm not giving everyone a hall pass. I think if you do the right thing, people will know you did the right thing, and you don't have to spin doctorate. Now that doesn't mean that we're perfect, but I think it goes back to integrity. You know, if you do that. It doesn't mean that there won't be a problem or there won't be a bug, but people will see that you tried to handle it the best way. And that's why I say we try to fix the things in severity order. The other part of it goes back to certain things that we impose on others. And I said, look, you know, if there's a problem, all the brand damage, first of all, there might be actual damage to somebody. But also, all the brand damage is on us if we didn't do the right thing. You know, we run our company on our own. Software and hardware, it's our customers. It doesn't make us perfect, but I'm very fortunate. I've never had a problem getting something attended to quickly, and management supports that. When your chief executive says, if any of you see somebody not doing something right in security, I want you to escalate it. You might think it's above your pay grade, it's not above my pay grade, and I have nothing better to do, and means it, and that is repeated, that's a good place to be. And so I can't answer the larger question about that. To me, it gets back to, you know, do unto others. You know, we run our own company on our own software and our own clouds. So, you know, that is part of our risk and also protecting our customers. And since the company's inception, security has been an important cultural norm. And that's always the discussion I have with teams. It's not about the thing that I really want to do, and I have to really do a deep dive with a team that's struggling, is I need you to affect a cultural transformation. Security is really important, and if you don't do that, if we don't have every one of these people who understands he or she is personally responsible for the code he or she writes, we're going to fail. It's not about did you run a tool or did you do this or do that. It's trying to achieve that cultural transformation. And that's why I like what I do. It doesn't mean we're perfect at it, but I get the support I need, and we have seen struggling teams make that change, and then they go off and become security evangelists to other groups, and that's immensely satisfying. So I'm sorry I couldn't answer your question, but I'm not a licensing expert, and I try not to go into areas where I'm basically ignorant. But I feel your pain. Someone else? Question? What's the meaning of life? Who's my favorite Kardashian? Okay. Okay, 5 minutes. Oh, come on, somebody's gonna heckle me. Okay, no more questions. I wanna thank you for your attention. I hope you enjoy the conference. And if you missed some of these sessions I talked about, there really are machine learning tracks. I was blown away by how good a lot of those presentations were and how they incorporated this discussion into their presentation materials. And again, there was a legal one on Wednesday that I thought was outstanding that talked about this. So go for it. And safe journeys home, all of you.